Welcome to MetroView. I'm Beth Bowles. Families dealing with serious illness can find themselves in difficult situations both emotionally and financially. Fortunately, there is an alternative to long-term hospital stays. Adrian Anderson is the executive director of Anne's Haven Hospice, and she is here to tell us about a place that families can turn to. Thanks for joining me today, Adrian.
Oh, well, thanks for inviting me.
Let's start by you giving us really a complete description of what a hospice is.
Well, a hospice has really an alternative form of health care that started developing in the United States after St. Christopher's Hospice in England formed a hospice care after medieval model, where a hospice was a spiritual place where pilgrims came to rest when they were on religious journeys, and they also took care of the dying. And St. Christopher's Hospice in England is very famous for having integrated that model into modern health care. And Anne's Haven Hospice is the oldest hospice in the state of Texas, and we are formed after that model, where we are primarily spiritually based and believe that patients have the right to a peaceful and dignified death, and it is hospice's job to enhance the quality of life that remains. And we do that in numerous ways. We provide physical care for our patients. We have registered nurses on call 24 hours a day. We are experts in pain management and symptom control. We also look at the patient. Besides the patient's physical needs, we look to their spiritual, psychological and psychosocial needs, and try to really help the patient and the family make the most of the time that is remaining to tie up loose ends, to deal with those things which are the spiritual parts of making that transition when a family member is dying. We have volunteers we have over 250 volunteers at Anne's Haven who help us do all kinds of things, from direct patient care to running errands for patients to babysitting. We have a chaplain who directs the patient's spiritual care, and a lot of times that entails working with the ministers in our community to be sure that patients have, that churches are aware of what's happening with their members. And of course, all of that's done with permission of the patient and the family. Mm-hmm. And our chaplain's job is just to coordinate that care, although he does make visits himself, and he does do things called upon by the patient and family. Because sometimes people have things that they don't want to tell their own minister, or things they need to confide in someone, and then our chaplain will make a visit for those patients. We also provide all kinds of therapy, speech therapy, hearing therapy, occupational therapy, physical therapy, all of the things that you would expect in any kind of medical care. We have hospice health aides who go out and help with the physical needs of the patient, with bathing, changing linens, all of the kind of direct physical care that you would expect. We have medical social workers who help the families make arrangements, be sure that they're aware of the community resources that are there, and sometimes intervene to make things more comfortable for the patient and the family. But a lot of what hospice does is help people know what to expect, to be there for them, to help them anticipate what's going to happen. And then after the patient has died, then we follow our family members in a full bereavement program for a year or at least 2 years. And that's kind of typically what a hospice is. And we are, like I say, we're part of the mainstream medical care. Hospice has really grown in the United States. There are almost 2,000 hospice programs now throughout the United States. And we all have contracts with hospitals and nursing homes so that we can follow sometimes our patient's home is the nursing home, and then we continue to provide hospice services. And sometimes our patients need to be hospitalized because their care can't be managed at home, and then we contract with the hospital for hospice beds so that we continue to direct those patients' care. We are as a charitable hospice, we take care of all of our patients regardless of their ability to pay, and we have never sent our patients or their families a bill.
How is it funded then if the patients never have to pay?
Well, the medical part of care is reimbursed by Medicare, Medicaid, and private insurance. Most insurance, in fact all insurance companies in our experience so far, knock on wood, reimburse for hospice services for the direct medical part of the care. And then that care, which isn't covered by private insurance, Medicare or Medicaid, or perhaps the patient doesn't have any insurance at all, then we raise money directly from the community to supplement what insurance gives us. Foundation grants help us provide the additional equipment and things that we need, and corporations also are very helpful to us, and we receive United Way funding as well.
When you were describing it earlier, are hospices reserved solely for terminal types of illnesses?
Yes. Anyone, to be eligible for hospice care, you have to have a terminal diagnosis, meaning that you have a limited life expectancy. You have to not be seeking curative care. And the difference, the distinction is we do palliative care, which means we manage pain, we manage symptoms, we keep people alert, comfortable, in control of decisions about their care. But if someone wants a curative treatment and expects to recover from the illness, then they're not hospice appropriate, because we're helping people prepare for the eventuality of death, and so a patient that's seeking curative care wouldn't be appropriate for our service. But we do consults with people who have pain management and symptom control problems who still have curative options. We do chemotherapy and radiation if the chemotherapy and radiation is related to relieving symptoms as opposed to a cure. And of course, if a patient develops pneumonia or has an infection or breaks their arm, we continue to take care of that patient just as you would in the normal medical mainstream, because we don't do anything to hasten someone's death or to prolong their dying. We see our role as facilitating the quality of life for as long as possible.
You mentioned where hospices originally came from. Where did Ann's Haven originate?
Oh, Ann's Haven just has a wonderful story about how they originated. We have a physician in town, Dr. Lockwood, in Denton, Dr. Robert Lockwood, who is a radiologist, and his first wife, Ann Lockwood, who Ann's Haven Hospice is named after, she was just a real special lady, and she was a nurse, and she had cancer, and she had a remarkable ability to talk about what was happening to her, how she felt about how she was dying, and she made other people very comfortable with being able to talk to her about her dying. And she was essentially the first hospice patient that Ann's Haven took care of, and she, because her husband was a part of the medical community, when she was unable to be cared for at home, she and her entire family moved into a hospital suite, and there received hospice-like care where physicians, nurses, social workers, the chaplain, the psychologist, various people came and visited her throughout the day and night because she was there, and talked to her about what was happening to her. Then when she died, that group of people felt such a loss at her death that they formed a death and dying study group at St. Barnabas Church. And from that, they started having various people, they started studying Elizabeth Kubler-Ross's book on death and dying, and they had various speakers come, and they had a speaker come one day when they had been doing this for several months who was on the faculty of one of the colleges of nursing, and she came and talked to them about what hospice was. And at that time, the hospice in New Haven, Connecticut, the first one in the United States, was just opening. And this group got so inspired by that they sent some people there to a study program that they were putting on about how to form a hospice. And then these people came back to Denton and said, this is what we want to do. We're going to form a hospice. And so that's how Ann's Haven got started. But there's a love story in there, too, because the woman who came and
Wait a minute. This is a perfect opportunity for us to go to a break and make sure our viewers are going to come back.
All right,
so they'll hear the end of this
love story.
Right. Please stay with us for more Metro View. Welcome back to Metro View. Okay, Adrian, we promised the viewers if they stayed through the commercial break, when they came back, they'd have a love story.
Well, the love story part of it is that the woman who came and talked to the Death and Dying Study Group about hospice is now the second Mrs. Lockwood, Sandy Lockwood, and that's how they met, was in that group when she came and told them about hospice. And the Lockwoods have two beautiful young children, and that's what the love story is.
Great. Now, it's obvious that the hospice works in connection with hospitals.
Yes.
How strong must the commitment be from the medical community for a hospice to work?
Well, we work directly with the medical community, and when somebody is referred to hospice service, and that can be from a social worker or a hospital discharge planner or a family member or the physician themselves, then hospice always contacts the primary physician first, and that physician continues to direct the care of the patient. So we work very closely with hospitals, nursing homes, and the primary physicians.
And you mentioned earlier, many of the things that you're involved with in the hospice are acting as a patient advocate, almost. Do you think there's an absence of that in the medical community?
Well, I think that because we're real cure-oriented in our medical care, that hospice really sprung up as a response to that. And in fact, the hospice is often called the hospice movement. And basically, it came about because people within the medical profession said, with the state of the art of medicine today, there's no reason for anybody to die in pain and alone. And so hospice was developed as a very specialized kind of very high-tech health care for people who are terminally ill. And yes, I think that hospice in general is also impacting healthcare as a whole, so that we are more oriented toward the psychological and spiritual needs of people in relation to healing. I think that has definitely been impacted by what hospice has done.
It seems like this would greatly ease the turmoil that's going on in the family as well, because if you're in the hospital and one of your relatives is dying, there are a lot of needs that you have as a family. You're also treating those in the hospice, is that correct?
That's correct. And in that sense, hospice is a preventative health program. And in fact, it's the first time that Medicare has ever funded something that could be called preventative medicine. And the reason for that is that the research very clearly shows that when you have intervention like what hospice does with family members, that your illness related to stress because of the dying and following the death is dramatically decreased. So yes, we deal a lot of what we do is help people know what to anticipate, because with all of us, if we know what's going to happen, then we can figure out what we're going to do and how we're going to deal with it. It's the unknown. It's the wondering if 25 things are going to happen when the hospice nurse can say, no, we think this one thing or this other thing is going to happen, and you don't have to worry about the other things. So people can be more prepared.
In addition to that preparation, it's also a much more comfortable environment, is it not?
Oh, surely, because we keep people at home as long as possible. Their family is surrounding them. They're comfortable. Everybody can have their jammies on. Grandkids can come and go. Pets can still be there. It's a lot less stressful for everyone. And just knowing that the hospice is right there, they can call us up, we'll come out no matter what. Somebody will stay on the phone and talk to them until the nurse gets there. Whatever needs to happen, I think, makes a big difference for families. And it frees them to deal with those quality of life things with their family member rather than worrying about the physical care.
Well, we're going to continue talking about patients at home and what some of the special needs are in just a moment.
All right.
Please stay with us. Welcome back to MetroView. Adrian, when patients are in hospice care and they're staying in their home, can they receive medications at home, or do they need to go into the hospital for that?
No, we handle all of the patient's care in the home. And they can go to the hospital or to a nursing home facility if they need to, or situation demands it. But we take care of all their medical needs in the home, and hospice provides all of the patient's pharmaceuticals related to their terminal diagnosis, their durable medical equipment like wheelchair, walker, bedside commode, anything like that that makes things more comfortable, and we also supply their medical supplies. as a part of the entire hospice benefit.
Now, if a patient is home and the family is starting to feel overwhelmed, can the patient re-enter the hospital if need be?
Sure. Hospice has a program we call respite care. And in fact, a lot of times we find at Ann's Haven that we do more respite care in the home than we do by transferring the patient to somewhere else. Because when somebody's terminally ill and they need a lot of medical care, it's difficult for them to move. A lot of times that's very stressful for the patient. So many times when the patient's family needs a break, then we get 24-hour caregivers to come in and so the family can go somewhere and do mm-hmm. something. But we also have the ability to put a patient in for respite care in the hospital or in the nursing home to give the family a break if that's easier for the family.
Does it cost more for the patient to be at home than it would if they were in the hospital?
Well, one of the reasons that hospice has grown so much and become so integrated into the medical community is that we are very cost effective. It is much less expensive to be a hospice patient than to care for terminally ill people in the hospital or in the nursing home. And hospice is also unusual in healthcare in that we receive a per diem rate. We get paid a flat daily rate regardless of what it is we do in the medical management of the patient. And some of the things you're hearing about our new health care plan, other kinds of health care probably are going to go to the same kind of system.
You mentioned earlier that you provide many services for the families. Are there special programs for children that might be involved?
Surely. When we have children who are losing a parent, or just children who have a family member on service, we do very special things with those children. We do a lot of things individually and directly. We offer us individual counseling for those children. We try to get permission to contact school counselors so the school counselor and the school teachers are aware of what's going on. Mm-hmm. And then we follow children much more closely following the death of a parent than we do adults, for instance, because we figure adults can call us up and tell us if they need additional help, where with children we provide a lot of extra services.
Through your counseling programs, do you find that there are certain questions that are the ones that are most asked?
Oh, surely. I think that any time that somebody is experiencing the death of someone they love, that they go through periods of guilt where they feel like maybe they have caused the death or they wish they'd made a different decision about that, and people have to come to terms with that. I think there's a lot of, like, why is this happening? Why is this happening to our family? There's always a lot of questions involved around that spiritual questions and emotional issues that people have to deal with.
Well, we'll continue in just a moment. Please stay with us. Welcome back to Metro View. Adrian, what are some guidelines that you can use to help people deal with their grief?
Well, I think that it always helps people to talk to other people about their grief and to understand that grieving is a process. Many people think, I think society expects people be just fine in 2 weeks and back to work and acting like nothing happened. And in reality, it takes over a year, and usually 2 years, to really come to terms with a loss of somebody very close to you. So that's what I would suggest is that you have an opportunity to talk with others, that maybe you read something about grief and the process of that. A lot of times people have physical symptoms and are concerned about their health. So I think just knowing that it's a long process, that it takes time, that eventually you do have more good days than bad days, all of those kind of things, I think, help people through it.
Now, to make Ann's Haven possible, you have a number of fundraisers through the year. Can you tell me briefly about some of those?
Surely. We have our main fundraiser every year is called Light Up a Life, and we have a tree in Golden Triangle Mall in Denton and in Vista Ridge in Louisville where we have huge Christmas tree in front of the JCPenney stores at both of those malls where for $10 people can either honor or memorialize someone, and we put a dove on streamers coming down the tree with that person's name on it, and we have volunteers manning those trees throughout the holiday season, and that's really our main fundraiser that both of our auxiliaries, Friends of Hospice in Louisville and Ann's Haven Auxiliary in Denton, help us with those.
Do you have any smaller fundraisers throughout the year?
Oh, sure. We have, once a year, too, we have a sustaining drive where we have what we call a stay-at-home tea, and we send this little teapot with a tea bag, and the idea is you're supposed to make yourself a cup of tea and write a check. It's like a non-event, and that's been real popular. And then the Medical Society Auxiliary, or now they've changed the name to the Alliance, they help us once a year by doing a beautiful and wonderful fashion show and brunch. And then, of course, we receive a lot of memorial donations and contributions throughout the year.
As we get into the 90s and AIDS, of course, it's become more popular. Do you see more of a need for hospice care throughout the country?
Oh, yes. I think that we're going to see an increasing need for hospice care. I think that to contain health care costs, that we're going to see some rationing of health care. We're going to see some curative options not as available. So I think that we're going to see our hospice patients quicker and sicker. And then I think with the AIDS epidemic that we'll see more and more AIDS patients. Right now, throughout the United States, 84% of hospice patients have cancer, 4% have AIDS, and 12% have other diagnoses like end-stage renal disease, heart disease, Lou Gehrig's disease, any of the other terminal illnesses. But I think that we'll see that percentage of AIDS patients increase and that we'll see more and more utilization of this care.
For more information about Ann's Haven Hospice, is there a number they can call?
Oh, sure. They can call 1-800-383-5435.
Okay. I'd like to thank you for joining me today, Adrian.
Oh, well, thank you. I really enjoyed it.
For MetroView, I'm Beth Bowles. Thank you for joining us.